Our first presenters will be Philadelphia Young Playwrights.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, all. My name is Jay Gilman. I work for Philadelphia Young Playwrights. I'm going to briefly introduce the rest of my team, Mitchell Bloom and Mindy Early, as well as Davis Shaver, who was our resident technologist as a part of this residency. We are actually going to start with a short video just to contextualize a little bit about who we are as an organization, and then we will move into our presentation. So this video is about 3 minutes long. We hope you enjoy. Thank you.
I am an artist.
Person and to have professional people genuinely want to work on your piece with you and to defend your art and to bring it to life, it makes you start to imagine yourself as a professional artist in the future, and it's just been a really wonderful thing personally for me and for my confidence as a young artist.
My name is Lauren Murphy Sands. I taught at Ben Franklin High School on Broad and Spring Garden, and we worked on playwriting with my English 2 students. It made the kids okay with sharing their story and being honest about things that happened to them in their life, or even using stories of their life and infusing it with different characters. And I think the outlet of their life story through a creative writing process, I think, was monumental for some kids. I think it opened a whole new door to them.
It's funny, every time you go into a classroom, you notice different students and what their cliff will be, in a way. And cliff meaning what's the thing that they have to overcome. So seeing each student kind of look at the cliff and see it and then back away from it and then taking the moment to say, okay, no, I'm just gonna jump, is really awesome. And I think each student in every class that we go to, you see those little moments of leaps, and it's great.
Great, and now we're going to talk a little bit more about the TechniCulture residency.
So as the video hinted at, since we were founded in 1987, our goal is to transform the classroom paradigm, and we're looking at 5 key areas to do so. In 2016, which is a long way from 1987, this vision still holds true to us today. In 2013, we snuck one last bullet on this list that you don't see here, which is we started asking ourselves the question, can we use technology also as a catalyst in order to create this classroom transformation? So that is what our presentation is going to focus on today, our journey so far. So let's take a look at the structure that we're going to use today as we walk you through this process. So in today's presentation, We're going to look at the challenge where we were before the TechniCulture residency started, the solution that we came up with before TechniCulture, which was the Playwright Commons, and then a prototype of something that we've developed this year during TechniCulture, which you're going to enjoy with us later. Then we're going to share with you some lessons that we learned from TechniCulture, both in terms of our organization and in terms of partnering with a technologist. And finally, we'll share with you our dreams. So to kick us off, I'm going to hit it back to Jay, and he's going to talk about our stakeholders.
Great. So let's talk about some challenges. The first of these, as everything at Young Playwrights, starts with our teaching artists, our teachers, and our students. Teachers and learners face pretty fundamental challenges in the American education system, as many of us probably know. We expect teachers and teaching artists to succeed like this, in isolation from each other, and especially because Young Playwrights residencies are taught in 45 schools across the city and the surrounding counties, often where the teacher and teaching artist are the only people in that school working on playwriting as a form. It's very hard for them to feel like they have an ability to connect with each other as a larger community and advance learning together. And at the same time, as many of us know, I'm sure, we also expect students to succeed like this, in a sort of herd mentality, in an education system that was modeled originally after factories during the Industrial Revolution. And so we expect students to learn the same concepts in the exact same ways at the same pace, with very little ability for agency or choice. As an organization created to catalyze change in this system, we've done a lot, as Mindy explained, over the last 30 years to improve this paradigm. But technology can help us go much further in ways that we couldn't have even imagined 10 years ago to create digital communities in which we can share resources, knowledge, and allow our teachers, teaching artists, and our students to feel much more connected to each other as a community and advance knowledge in much more efficient ways. And so, in other words, we want to use technology to allow us to transform this paradigm into something that looks much more like this. So in this system, obviously, as you can see, these teachers and teaching artists are able to collaborate, share a community, and crowdsource best practices. And in classrooms and across classrooms, we can allow students to have a much greater sense of individualized learning, a sense of agency in their schools, and choice over what they learn and how they learn it. And we're going to show you some of that actually in a little bit, so you'll become the students as part of this presentation. So what does this actually look like? Over the last 2 years, we've basically stumbled our way through some technological solutions to create something that we call the Playwright Commons. This is a screenshot of what that looked like before the TechniCulture residency. This is basically a basic WordPress website. It acts as a hub for our teachers and teaching artists, and soon, our students. The site is accessible via any device, a mobile phone, a tablet, or a computer, and we've intentionally made this adaptable to combat the issues of digital equity that are so prevalent in Philadelphia as a school system and as a city. Quickly, we use basic free tools. We have blog posts on here for exercises, we use Google Forms, Google Drive, and we've created a rough-hewn community that does things like allow us to share exercises with each other, worksheets, and more. Our teaching artists submit a form after each session, for example, where they send us qualitative and quantitative data that we can use in grants and fundraising. We have some virtualized professional development that existed on here and a few other things. And the Commons was sort of good enough for now when we first built it, but we really needed help to take it to the next level. And Mitchell and Davis are both going to tell you a little bit more about some of the other challenges we faced to actualize this to where we needed it to go.
So some of the reasons, well, all of the reasons that we needed something like TechniCulture and more opportunities like this is that, like it or not, we don't have someone on staff at a small nonprofit who has the capacity to do this or the know-how technologically to be building platforms and maintaining them and have them be user-friendly and sophisticated and to interface the way that all of the technology that we all use every day works. So all of us are doing multiple things at Young Playwrights, which reminds me that if you could all wave and say hello. I will tweet that out, hashtag TechniCulture, in about 5 minutes. So things all along that line, that doing these tech projects when we choose to engage in them takes time, it takes effort, it takes knowledge, it takes a tremendous amount of capacity and capital. And we're always fighting the timeline of getting the grants and the support from foundations and those sorts of resources to be able to forward the work. And Davis will sort of come up now and talk about where we were when he joined us, which was very much at a plateau. We had a platform, we were adding to it, but it wasn't advancing in terms of capability and the ways that it can work for students and teachers.
Cool. Thanks, Mitchell. So when I started talking to playwrights, I was really impressed with how far they had gotten already. The team had found WordPress as an easy way to pull together that first iteration that you saw earlier. Sure, some of the solutions were a little bit hacky, but it was clear the team hadn't let technology be a blocker for trying things out. As far as site development goes, there were a handful of low-hanging enhancements that we started working on immediately. The first was user roles and permissions for different audience types.
Jay, what does he mean when he says that?
In culture speak, what Davis means is that we basically wanted our teachers, teaching artists, and students to see different things on the site depending on their identity.
Mm-hmm. And so the next one was structured content and relationships between PYP concepts like exercises, writer's bin items, and play library books.
In other words, we wanted our teachers and teaching artists to intuitively be able to find the tools that they needed for their classroom's specific needs quickly.
We needed a user-friendly tool for creating interactive forms.
We wanted playwrights to be able to play cool learning activities on their mobile devices and on computers that they might have at school.
And then we needed a form extension to turn staff and admin form submissions into PDFs that were stored for business use.
Basically, we wanted to allow us to easily send a receipt to our teaching artists so that they could have a copy of their form for their own records and learning.
And lastly, we needed some more multimedia publishing capabilities.
We wanted to show cool photos and videos of exercises and previous winning plays to our teaching artists, students, and teachers to inspire their learning and drive them forward. So we're going to talk a little bit about what all of these things Davis mentioned actualized as. This is a wireframe, which is a term that I learned from Davis as a part of this residency. So this is a wireframe of one of those elements. This is our Lights Up activity guide. This is basically where all of the exercises are that form lesson plans over time. There's a lot of rich elements here. I won't go into each of them, but some of the things that you can see on here are being able to sort exercises by the teaching artist or teacher who created them. So if you really like a teacher's style, you can find all the things that they've added to the community. You can sort things now by categories, such as character or settings, or by tags, which are more qualitative things, like in your seat versus on your feet. We also have a video that now, if you don't understand the words that are listed in terms of the exercise, you can just simply watch a video of that exercise being previously facilitated in another classroom so that you feel comfortable actualizing it. Teachers, teaching artists can comment on the page so that they can give tips and tricks from when they facilitated it in their own classroom. On the right-hand side, you can see that you can easily download media. So this exercise is something that uses music and worksheets. Great, you don't have to go find music anymore. You just download it on the site. We have music that works great, a PDF of the worksheet if you need it. And the last thing I'll point out at the top is Common Core curricular standards. So every exercise is tied to Common Core standards, which are, whether we like it or not, increasingly important to teachers in terms of their relevancy in facilitating things. So this is a prototype of something that we've done for teachers and teaching artists primarily. Mindy is actually now going to take us through a prototype of another element we've been working on with Davis. This one is a virtualized activity for students, and you all will be the students.
All right, so here we go. It is time to do something together, because we at Young Playwrights are doers, and we would like you to do with us this morning. If you haven't already, but I think we did so well this morning, please connect to the Wi-Fi. And then take out your device. So that device can be a mobile device, it could be a laptop, it could be a tablet. Any of those work great for this. When you have your device out, because I'm a teacher and a teaching artist and a facilitator, please hold it up or your hand up so I know that we're ready to keep on trucking. You guys are so fast. Thank you so much. So here we go. We want you to imagine with us that you are now students in a ninth grade English classroom. I am now your teaching artist, the one who is the professional artist coming to you facilitating the activity. And for the purposes of today, Jay functions as the teacher because he might be floating around and seeing how you students are doing. If this were a real classroom, really important, we would have 50 minutes with you to integrate this full activity and to debrief it with you and all of that. And it would also be one of 25 sessions, as we mentioned earlier, that we would have with you. We also, so for the purposes of today, we want to keep in mind, we only have 5 minutes to do this with you because we have a lot of awesome things to say afterwards. This activity is a prototype. It has not yet been tested in a classroom, and you are our largest audience who's about to test it with us. So we're really excited in a frightened way. This space is not an ideal classroom. There is going to be a moment very early on in the activity where you get to choose whether you want to do the individual side or the group side. If you choose the group side, you will be prompted to find groups in the middle of the activity. You do not have to find a group right now. But if that means moving around the space, if you're feeling sedentary today, go with the individual path, please. And as you're proceeding through the activity, don't hit the back button because then you'll have to refill in all those fields. Like if you hit the back button when you're filling in your credit card information while you're doing Grubhub and you made a mistake, same thing here. So please don't hit the back button. We ready to go? Great. So please go to this link. And once again, when you are ready to proceed, please hold your hand or your device in the air. So I want to make sure as many of you are at the link as possible and at the site. No pressure. It's more important to get the link right than to do it fast, for sure. Error message. Is everyone getting an error message or just some of you? Do you want to try? Yesterday we logged into the internet a second time. We had to go back in and re-enter our email. Try that and see if that works. How many of you have internet right now? Cool. Has anyone tried re-logging in and did you get internet if you did so?
It took me 2 times, yeah.
Took 2 times. If worst comes to worst, your device does not get internet on it, see if your neighbor has it and you can follow along with them and maybe do the individual side of the activity together.
They also can use data. It's a really data.
Yeah, it's a data limited exercise, so if you also want to sneak on your own device's Wi-Fi in order to participate, you can do that. We promise that we won't suck all your data up. So can I have a show of hands again? Who has... Oh, the link. There you go. So when people are at this link, can you show your hands, please? So I know we're ready, most of us. Still no connection. So we're just going to jump in and do, see if you can find a neighbor who has a connection, because unfortunately the internet connection here is beyond our control, even though we tested it yesterday. All right? So can, those of you who have connection and have this activity on your phones, can you hold your phones nice and high so people can gravitate towards you if they really want to see this activity? Awesome. If you want to get up and share with a neighbor, please go. Please move. Don't be afraid. Don't get locked out of this activity because you don't have internet.
I wonder if anyone has access to it. Or the other thing we can do is show it up here.
We can show it up. We'll also try to show it up here. We're going to try to think creatively. But... for those of you who have internet, we're going to start the countdown with 5 minutes, and you can proceed through the activity at your own pace. Are you ready? Great. Go. Do you want to pop on and see if we can...
That's what I think, yeah.
So Young Moo just let us know that it's not the internet, it's our server. So as we said, like, TechniCulture, why we need TechniCulture? Because we tried for weeks to make this a thing that would function today and it's not. So instead of stumbling through trying to make it work. I think we should just move forward. What it was and is an interactive activity that leads you either through a group setting or an individualized setting based on your choice as a student, and leads you through various steps, either starting with setting or with character, to move through the beginning of getting a play started. So again, in the classroom, there'd be more time to do it. If and when all of our platforms and servers and all of the things that are back-end kind of things are sophisticated enough to be able to support these kinds of things, students would be able to mobily access it. And for that matter, you guys all have that link now, and it will be open to you and available if you're bored on the train and want to check out what we tried to show you today. And like we said, those are all things that are tied to very specific curricular core standards that teachers then would be able to refer back to and to integrate those activities into their classroom should they choose.
Cool, so we're gonna move on to lessons learned, including the one we just learned right now. So as you can see and feel with us this morning, there are some pretty huge lessons here as we tackle this beast of really letting technology impact the core of our program and what we do here. So we're constantly, like right now, assessing our technological capacity. That doesn't just include hardware. It includes the technological literacy of our entire staff and our capacity and time, as we touched on earlier, to be able to build and maintain these platforms. We want to share with you today, there's been a significant shift in several staff positions, not just programming related positions, but across organization as we try to integrate technology into the lifeblood of our organization. We might even have a need to create a new staff position that is completely technology and media oriented. We're currently evaluating that right now, and that's a question that we have. Since 2013, we've been seeking continual new funding resources specifically in order to build these technological platforms. And obviously, our operations costs have increased as we try to build capacity on site, and we look toward building capacity off site in classrooms. Regarding our partnerships, we've had several partners so far. Being partners with people has been really interesting as we try to figure out what we really need. We're also continually figuring out who our right partner is. So that's one challenge, but I want to hit back on the funding part of that again. When we have to each year find a new funding source or apply to a funding source we had in the past, that's been really inconsistent. And what we want as an organization is someone who can partner with us, not just for 1 year, but for multiple years, so that we really can land with them, develop language with them, and continue on with them. So speaking of partners, I'm going to hit it back to Davis, and he can talk about some other lessons learned.
Yeah, well, let's start with load testing. Obviously something that we hadn't done prior to today's demo, and I take responsibility for that. We will get you the updated link as soon as the server's rebooted, and I hope you guys get to enjoy the exercise that Playwrights put together. That said, there are some other lessons that I wanted to share with you, and here they are. So we used these as our North Stars to orient ourselves throughout our work together. Let's start with the first one. Don't let perfect technology be the enemy of good technology. Playwrights demonstrated this so well with version 1 of their commons. When you feel like you've got a lead on a solution as a resource-constrained organization, figure out the quickest and lowest way to validate it. Don't wait for the grant to come through or the perfect person or any other excuse you might have for delaying. Prototyping solutions with whatever tools are available results in a deepened understanding of the problem, opportunities that are riper for a technologist than they might be. If PYP had waited for a developer to try version 1 of their solution, it wouldn't be as ripe for the work that we take together. And with tools like Google Docs, Zapier, Trello, and WordPress, you have these opportunities within reach today, just needs a little bit of elbow grease. The second one is know yourself, but entertain doubt as well. The beauty of mission-driven organizations is that the why of our work is usually a little more meaningful than the why of a for-profit corporation. It might sound counterintuitive, but willingness to entertain doubt is a big factor here. Working with PYP, I always felt they had a sense of their goals and were willing to entertain doubt as we figured out the best way to achieve them without jumping to technology too quickly. In the interest of time, I want to turn it back over to PYP so they can finish up.
Thank you.
So very quickly, we're almost out of time. We just want to give you a few dreams of where we want to go from here with this support from today and hopefully future support. Here are some quick visions that we see in the future. We want to fundamentally transform the way that our teachers, teaching artists, and students think about education, agency, and technology in our programs, and more generally in our school system. Things like customized resources, customized assessments, one of which you would have seen today and you'll hopefully see in a little bit, the ability to upload and share best practices, connecting with other playwrights, not just at their school, but across schools about the plays that they're writing, virtual support, controlling their own learning, which is so important, enrolling in things like virtual residencies. If you're not lucky enough to have a program at your school, great, log in today, you can start writing a play right away. And things like access from any device. And the last thing we'll leave you with is this quote from Daniel Renner, the Director of Education from Theater Development Fund, who was part of an original study that we did a few years ago. And I think this sums up where we're uniquely positioned to go from here, and we hope you agree.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Jay, Mindy, Mitchell, and Davis. And at this point, we have 5 minutes for the judges to ask any questions they may have. Go ahead.
Did you experience any either anecdotal or even quantitative?
Did you experience any qualitative or even measurable impact in collaborations between teachers? And I mean, have you seen any impact results in the collaborations, either anecdotally or that you can quantify from optimizing your platform?
Immediately, and it's been pretty life-changing for us in a sort of day-to-day operations way, and also for our teaching artists in terms of buy-in, our teachers in terms of buy-in. We often used to serve as a sort of conduit, so it was a one-to-one line where teachers and teaching artists would be constantly asking us for resources. Hey, do you know of a good exercise for this? Hey, do you know, et cetera, et cetera. And now it's a web of communication. So instead of, by default, asking one of us for that resource, they can go look immediately on this website for that. And they also know who else to ask in the community. So there's a lot more peer-to-peer learning that started to happen. And it's been really transformational in that way.
Cool. So with this type of platform, part of the challenge is getting students to actually go to the platform and use it themselves. So that's one of the, I guess, like one of the risks. And they have so many other distractions and other things that they want to log into, especially when they get onto a computer or on their phone. So I guess, what are ways that you would incentivize them to actually, you know, log into this platform and continue to use it?
Yeah, I just want to add that. Jay will take the bulk of this, but I do want to say one thing to that, which is the commons exists because of students. When we started with our first technology partner, we said to students, how would you want young playwrights to use technology for the organization? We expected that they were going to say, like, a young playwright's video game or something like that. What they actually said was that they were going home on YouTube and watching videos about playwriting, and they were looking for other sources online to help them write their plays at home, and that they would like a young playwright's curated place where they could actually do that individualized learning through us and know that the content was online with what we were teaching them and things like that. So it started with the students.
Yeah, I don't have much to add, but I think one sort of fundamental part of that is making it easy to log on. So perhaps having each classroom have a log on or something like that so that each student doesn't have to take time to do it. And then I think there's also ways that this will be sort of baked into the residency itself as this goes forward so that logging on is a part of your classroom experience and that you get into the habit of doing that as a student in the classroom, and hopefully the next year or for a friend that you're referring to it, that becomes a part of the culture. So we have 2,500 students built in each year who will be doing this as part of their classroom experience, hopefully them going home afterwards in years future to do that. So it's sort of built into the culture.
What kind of pushback did you get from the teachers?
I'm trying to think really hard. I mean, certainly we have different levels of technological literacy in terms of our teachers. But I think in terms of communication, most of our teachers are willing to roll with us on this for two primary reasons. It's made lesson planning with the teaching artist a lot easier, and that communication, it takes a lot less time. They can comment on the teaching artist's lesson plan right on Google Docs instead of emailing back and forth. And the other thing is that
They have much more control and access to their students' plays than they have ever had before. And their students are also receiving individualized feedback, not just in the classroom, but outside the classroom. So those things that are actually helping give teachers control back are making them a little bit more willing to be on yet another platform when they already have so many as teachers. So no really hard pushback yet.
What would success look like in 5 years from now?
It's cheating with a slide that we had to skip. Largely something that's just more consistent in terms of, like, it's been a lot of stop and start and a lot of iterating and prototyping and piloting, which is useful. However, the like both of those two said, in terms of like transformation in the organization, is having someone who's able to do this, having the resources that make it able to continue to happen, so that the activity, for example, that we prototyped for today is one of many, and they've all been developed and refined and used, and it's just a long feedback loop in terms of getting these things to move forward. And I think success in 5 years looks like that feedback loop looking a lot shorter and a lot easier.
Yeah, I think from a on the ground perspective, you know, like the sort of my dream, my vision in my head, like what I would love to see is, I ran into one of my students on the subway on the way here this morning, and like I would love in that moment or even on his own for him to be thinking of and dreaming of his play on the way to school, on the way home from school. He's meeting and collaborating with a student who lives in an area of Philly he's never been to before. You know, it's a very sort of segregated community here in Philadelphia, and we want to use playwriting as a way to catalyze students to connect with each other about their plays in new ways. So I think, like, that's the dream for me, is that they're sort of dying to get on this app, share their art with each other, connect with each other on a daily basis between their classes, et cetera.
One more question?
One more question.
What is your plan, if you have one, to share your learnings with other institutions, comparable institutions, so that they don't have to reinvent the wheel?
The last bullet there, I think, really speaks to that.
We don't have a comprehensive plan yet, but we certainly know that since we've been doing this since 2013, that we probably have, through presentations like this one, a lot of learning that we can share with organizations, a lot of platforms, like we mentioned, that we could share with organizations. And our impetus right now today is that we would like to dedicate our time to helping arts organizations in that way, rather than selling our model of what the content on the commons is itself, because that's very specific to young playwrights. But when we're ready for it, which we feel like is pretty soon, we are looking into that, certainly.
Can I make one last comment? DigitalOcean, great server company, allows flexible resizing. I've tripled the capacity on the box. I'm going to put the link on Twitter. If you have a moment, check it out. It's really great what they've put together for you. Thank you.
Thank you.